All right, so today I'm going to talk a little bit about William the Conqueror and Waltheof. Now, there were several Waltheofs, but yesterday I was talking about Earl Uhtred the Bold, and so from that line, Earl's father, Uhtred's father was actually a Waltheof, and so they kept the name Waltheof through. So it went to Eldred, and then it went to Siward, then to Waltheof. Okay, so here's this Waltheof, the son of Siward. And this is Northumbria. Now, this is really before the castle was built of Durham. Castle Durham was actually quite interesting. Sorry, I don't know where my hair went. Something happened to it. The castle was actually built by William the Conqueror. Now William the Conqueror and Waltheof had a big run-in. Waltheof ended up being the last, well, he was classed as the last Anglo-Saxon to have fought the Normans. So the Normandies, the Normandy invasion and William, this was really the last big power against William when he was in the north. What happened, I have this one page is pretty good. I'll show you, we'll see. Well, here's, first we'll say Waltheof here, we have him born 1030 in Northumbria. And then we have William born 1024 in Falaise, so in Normandy. So very, very similar time frame, almost same age, just 6 years apart. So they were combative. This is the same bloodline, yes. So we're having the combat of these two major figures in the north. We're seeing, I'll go into the revolt. Now, actually, they do have some poems about him that you could read further, which is interesting. It also talks about how Waltheof had hundreds of William's retainers. And I when they say retainers, I guess they were the soldiers that were left behind and were just supposed to hang around, you know, the, yeah, we've claimed it's ours now type of thing. Well, apparently they were scorched, all of them. They were burnt in a hot fire, and it became a scorching evening for the men. Literally, and the wolves ate their corpses of the Normans. So this was the last Anglo-Saxon hit, essentially, against the Normans. And this was all from Waltheof. So Waltheof was a pretty ferocious leader against old conqueror himself. Eventually, though, William, I'm sorry, it says here that William betrayed Waltheof and had him killed. Okay, so now I'm getting confused. Made 100 retainers of William burn in hot fire. Yeah, here they have him. He spent a year in confinement before he was beheaded. So William had him beheaded near Winchester. He was said to have spent months there, and he prayed and he fasted. People believed in his innocence and were surprised when the execution was carried out. His body was thrown into a ditch, and so it was a pretty terrible event. However, Yeah, I'm not sure why they're saying here in the second poem that William betrayed Waltheof and had him killed, because it sounds like Waltheof killed 100 of the retainers in the fire in the first poem. So it sounds like a little bit of who did what. It sounds like that it was Waltheof. It was called the Revolt of Earls. Maybe this will help clarify the earls themselves. Earls, if you're British, you have to say earls really high up. It's the earls, the revolt to the earls, really. And so off goes William, and they're all against William. All these earls, they didn't want William around. His motives for taking part in the revolt are unclear, but he did so. And I'm not sure why they would say that. I would think that would be an obvious. He told his wife, Countess Judith, that the plot, about the plot, and that she informed the archbishop, then told the Uncle William, who was at the time in Normandy. So apparently a little bit of this and a little bit of that, and maybe it was all Judith's fault, that she told about the plot. So now that's getting interesting. Yeah, apparently there's an Uncle William there that was telling. Maybe that really was William the Conqueror uncle, or just another William. There are a few Williams in the line that are just subsequent Williams. Yeah. Okay. So other sources say that Waltheof, who told the bishop of the plot. On William's return from Normandy, Waltheof was arrested and brought twice before the court of the king and sentenced to death. So it's murky what happened. This is all 1075, this big revolt, but it's murky exactly the fighting moment. And it looks like the fighting moment itself ended up being this big scorching evening for the men of these 100 retainers. So yeah, am I wrong in what retainers are in war? I really thought they were the ones that they left behind. So I mean, I can understand that that would be a terrible thing. Yeah, not that of war. Retainer agreement. Yeah, it's a body of persons retained in the service of. So yeah, they were left behind. Retinue, it's actually a French word. So they were they it was it, I was right. Okay, so these two, we have Waltheof, trying to be here with this revolt of the earls, and then we have William, and William eventually beheaded Waltheof, and Waltheof did the damage of the 100 retainers and burnt them in a fire, according to the poem, and the wolves ate the corpses. So it sounds a little gruesome. They really did kick up the gruesome, didn't they? And for some reason, his statue here that they identify as Waltheof is kind of, he has a little doggy. What's going on there? Yeah, he Judith, now apparently Judith is troublemaker to letting the cat out of the bag about the earls having a revolt. She was the daughter of Lambert, and Lambert the second, Count of Lens and Adelaide of Normandy. So those two, let's see if I have that. I'm sure I do have that written here. Yeah, there they are. That's the two. That's Lambert here and Adelaide. So now, oh, weird. I got master record. Now, I imagine that means it's really important when you see that. So that's cool. But yeah, Judith of Lens here. She was the one was a bit of a gossip. So that ended up be coming back right at her, and he ended up being beheaded. But let's go through. And they did have a little Alice of Huntingdon. Now, Huntingdon, Northumberland, is a she's an Adelise. Now, I wanted to still show you the castle of William's build, because once the beheading happened, it was really the end. You know, you're looking at this line here. It's the end of this group, this Anglo-Saxon group, the that came in from the Danish. So it's the end of them, and it's really saying, well, it's the Norman era. You know, it's the big Norman break-in. And to do that, what did they do? They built a castle. And where is it? I should have it here. I'll try to find it. It should be here. This is a picture of Waltheof. Yeah, so let's find that Northumbria castle. I thought I had it present, but now it wanted to run away. All right, so I have to seek it out. Okay, oh, this is a good image I found out there from someone's Facebook. This is a good little, it's called History Time. There's a Facebook called History Time. And so here they have, I believe this is Waltheof here, or this one, could be this one. But note the dragon here, the wolf. It looks like a little wolfy dragon, almost like a dog dragon, but he's there, you know. He's there with this big fight. So a lot of this is all about the earls, the revolt of the earls, and he was really the only English lord. Oh, here it says the only English lord of high birth to be executed during the reign of William of Normandy. So yeah, so that's a bummer for him, but that's the way it goes. They were gonna fight it out, weren't they? I note in all of this, they're showing they're blonde redhead, blonde redhead, blonde redhead. They're really trying to make that very clear in this art. I'm not sure if that was necessary, but yeah, there's I don't see any dark hair in this group. But yeah, they all have the round swords again, the round shields, and they have spears, and a few of them have axes. This one has an axe. Yeah, the pole axe they called it. Somebody was very famous for the pole axe. One of this line, one of these leaders of this line was famous for the pole axe. And so yeah, so it looks like sabers, pole axes, and regular spears were their weapons. So yeah, he Waltheof himself decided to join as the last male member of the House of Wessex. So with Edgar Atheling, alongside the Danish army. So he was there doing that, and then he was allowed to marry. There was a time there where he was allowed to marry his niece. He married his niece. Oh my gosh, I don't think I want to hear this. Now we got a bunch of those wackos. All right, so I'm going to read it again. The attack failed. They were marching on York alongside the Danish army, and the attack failed. However, the rebellions were put down by William. So here comes old William the Conqueror, and who at this time was fairly lenient to the rebellious lords, restoring Waltheof to his earldom even in 1070 and allowing him to marry his niece. Oh, I got it. I got it now. So William the Conqueror? No, I didn't. William the Conqueror is the uncle of Judith. Maybe there is a connection there. They're not saying it. So that's what the marrying the niece was not anything strange. It was actually William's niece that was allowed to marry Waltheof. So there was some kind of weird, we fight you and then we don't fight you. But eventually he ended up becoming, part of the group that was beheaded. I mean, come on. So yeah. Anyway, so it's, I know it's a great image, isn't it? It's very nice. I'm kind of talking spastic today. I'm trying to calm down. Maybe this will help, I don't know. In the aftermath of that rebellion, yeah, this is where the Ralph is there, the tosni. Now, I was talking a lot about, that there was a moment when there was a between Siward and Waltheof, and there was nobody in leadership, and a tosni came along. And there is also tosni in the line. Here's the Randolph de Tony, so he could be the Tosney one, or at least he's a brother of the Tosney. And so these ones were all with some kind of probably in here filling the gap, because when Siward died, there was a space here, and so it wasn't a direct father to son rule of the region. One of the Tosnies moved in and ruled for a short while. Over here they're calling him Tosni or Tony. So that group. So it sounds like William was a little bit on tiptoes there, that he kind of was, yeah, I'm still kind of gonna be friends with. And yet other times maybe, this is the last straw, and it ended up being the last straw for Waltheof. I know I'm not explaining this very well. Oh, there was one thing. I really wanted to just see the castle today. Where's the Durham Castle? It wanted to run away. Yeah, it was a major achievement for William. It's a pretty cool one. Well, yesterday I showed you that one, but this one is a pretty good one. Good heavens, not this type of site. They never even show you the castle. Okay, so I'm gonna have to go to images. There we go. Okay, look at that. It has nice grounds, actually. Very, very interesting center there. A little gatehouse, and then the walls around it. Yeah, so it was a very, very cool look as far as castles go. I believe it's on a hill also. So William was responsible for this build, and you could say this is the very odd. Was this the 1072, the turret type of? They're not turrets, I know, but those little edgy things on top. Was that 1072 look that did all that? Those cuts. It could be. Yeah, this would be more of a turret, but it's not a complete round room. Yeah, but it does have a nice look. This was a something he could be proud of. Today, I believe it's still standing. Doesn't look like it's fallen out of orbit. They're using it as the College Durham now, a World Heritage Site. So apparently the college students are there. So it's not just a visitor castle. But this was really, now William is saying, that's it, it's Normans. The Normans are here, and it's no longer Anglo-Saxon territory. When he went in for this build, he was real serious. So this was really the end of the end for that group of, I'll say they were all blonde, weren't they? Blonde and red-headed. Yeah, they were the Norwegian, Swedish, parts of Sweden, parts of Denmark. Yeah, actually, probably all of Denmark. Take it back. Oh, here's a good one, overhead view. Yeah, very, very good, cozy environment there, isn't it? Especially for a college. It's not bad. It's not bad at all. Now, it's located inland. It's nothing exciting. It's not on the edge of the ocean. Not like the former one I was talking about, Babenberg. No, this one is almost like an Oxford style. So I can understand why they would look at it as a college environment. So yeah, this is good old William the Conqueror getting involved here. So yeah, I think that's all I have today. I'm speaking nonsense and repeating myself, so I'm pretty tired. Yeah, I guess it really is a U now, a university. Well, good for them. Well, as a university, they need more flora. This isn't enough. They're not doing well making just a static green here. We're not beheading people any longer. So they need to stop that. Anyway, back to world global climate. Anyway, that's enough for today.